Hey, Grio family, it's your girl, Natasha Alford here. And, you know, we're here with none other than the prolific, iconic showrunner, writer, producer, director. Just put respect on her name either way. Mara Brock Akil. Hi, Mara. How are you?
Hi, Natasha. How are you? I love that intro. So I should call you every morning.
I'm here to
hype you up. My ego loves it.
You deserve your roses. I saw your Instagram post with you and this beautiful blowout from back in the day. And you were like, I'm thankful for my roses right now. And you deserve them. How does it feel? It's like this season, I like to call it manifestation because it's just a full circle season. It feels like all your work is coming together and you're manifesting a new chapter. So how are you feeling?
You know, it's interesting. I use that word a lot, manifestation. I have, I just want to sort of be a commercial for it or like a PSA for it, because sometimes manifestation, you know, when we do it, we're like, okay, you open your eye after 5 minutes and you want it there at that moment. But 20 years later to celebrate girlfriends, really also 20 plus years later in my career to be partnered with Netflix on such a global level. I'm a global storyteller. And I come through the specificity of us, but I'm a global storyteller, and it's nice to finally have my dreams manifested, you know, and while manifesting dreams along the way, if that makes sense. So I am very thankful is another way that I feel. I'm grateful beyond that I still have the privilege of being in the game, you know, and speaking of the game, also having the game being celebrated. What's a phenomenal breakthrough show. I hope that it also can get its respect for the, I think in that particular show, we really forged ahead the hybrid dramedy, you know what I'm saying? And really pushing narrative forward that I see the younger storytellers or the new storytellers on the block just killing it as a result of just building on what was there before us. Not just what I was doing, but other, you know, but building and growing. And so I'm thankful. I am happy to be a witness to the manifestation so I can testify that it works and that you could have that everyone should have it in their life.
I love it. And you know why I love this, Mara? Because you say, you know, you are a human, you tell human stories for a global audience, but you've never shied away from service and love to Black people. You know, you center Black women, you center our experiences, and it's about time, damn it, you know, that it's like, you've been on big networks, but for Netflix to understand the importance of your stories and to give you that space is great. So Channing Dungey, VP of original series at Netflix, is also a Black woman, so I love that, you know, she's in this position as well. What do you think about this moment right now? Because it seems like the whole world is kindly or finally acknowledging that Black Lives Matter, at least like in a corporate sense. But how do you think we expand this moment so that it's not just a season of people, you know, committing to Black talent and Black stories and Black initiatives, but that we really like make it last? Does that make sense?
Oh yeah, I think we've been trying to do that for years. We've been for generations. I think we know that we are a part of the DNA of this country. We know that we are a part of, in the global sense, that we are human, and so much effort has been done. Think about the energy, time, money that has been spent to dehumanize us. So I first want to acknowledge how beautiful and resilient and successful we have been because we are here. I know there's quotes that say, you know, I am enough. That the rebellion is being alive. You say that, okay. So we've got that. So now we want our full rights as human beings, our full expression. So how do we do that? We do it, I know the way I want to do that in the way that I do believe is my building legacy. Speaking the names before us, understanding that you did not get here alone, and bringing the legacy with you so that it also makes you remember on a daily basis, how do you pay it forward? Whether the institution acknowledges it or not, is important that we acknowledge it, that I have, in this moment, I have space to take up, you know, even that you're supporting me, I support you. We have to come into that mindset that we will, by natural progress, make sure that we make systemic change, dismantle it if we have to, reinstate it. But I think it's very important that we understand that there's a lot we can do right where we stand. And that is remembering our legacy and carrying that legacy forward. That lift as you climb, that's how I was raised. And I think that's what I'm also happy that my career reflects a lot of the blooms that have come from my tree. And I hope that the Kenya Barrises, the Karen Gist, the Prentice Pennies, the Lena Waits, and they're going to keep planting their trees and keep blooming. That's how we do. We keep blooming. We should celebrate ourselves, but to remember the celebration needs to be inclusive and we bring others. And I'm repeating myself now, but I think I want to get that we have power where we stand. And when we continue to stand, then we also then make space in the DNA of whatever industry that we're in. The demands, we build that confidence. We know that we are bringing a level of value that my voice will be heard. And these are the changes that I demand that need to happen. Like one of my biggest things that I'm talking about, I'm raising children. No, forget this people of color business. No, I'm not a person of color. I'm Black. And until people of color know what it is like to be Black, then when we can all be people of color, then maybe we'll just be all human at that point. But this lumping us in, and that's my voice now. No, I'm Black. You have to understand what the Black experience is. Sometimes I realize, you know, we know that the original woman is a Black woman. Maybe all of this, this hate we have to suffer through sometimes is because everybody's so jealous. You know, when you start life, right. You want to dehumanize my life. But I'm happy to be in the fight with my pen.
I love that, the fight with your pen. You know, what's beautiful about Girlfriends is that there is a new generation that's rediscovering. And also a generation like me I was a little too young when Girlfriends.
Yeah, you were.
Fully understand it. And now I'm in my mid 30s and I'm like, oh my God, like I went through that too. You know, how does it feel to, connect across generations? And some of these stories, they're just so universal. It doesn't matter when you were born, it's a part of womanhood, you know? What do you think about these new generations discovering these stories?
I love it because it's basically a way for me to have a conversation with that generation. You know what I'm saying? And it's by getting the story in the bottle, it has washed ashore to this generation at a time when they need it. It's kind of like Baldwin. Baldwin is everywhere. And he took the time to bottle up the work so that we would be ready when we were hungry. You know what I'm saying? And so I think my audience, the audience that I wrote for at the time, they get to revisit it and just have a celebration. And so the new audience is like taking notes. I had ran into a young lady the other day. She goes, I pulled out my pen, Mar. You were talking about things that we're just now sort of like trying to fight against. Like we were talking about fibroids and some of the things that, you know, Black women were going through. But remind it, we're still going through it. And again, that word legacy, we've been going through it. Mm-hmm. And we're still in that fight. Don't forget that. And it's okay to make strides. Just remember that we've got to progress this. So, and also I think, hey, whatever you're going through right now, it's okay. We all been tracing the dreams, the man, the job, you know, the house, the furniture, the style, the hair that we've been doing. And then it's okay. Just grab some friends and do it together and have some laughs and maybe get through the fights a little easier than Tony Jones. Maybe not be so, but I wanted to show, one of the big conversations I wanted to have with Girlfriends is that people, I see the comments, they're so toxic. Well, when we don't heal ourselves, we're going to be toxic to everybody. And I think that, allowing Tony, Joan, Maya, and Lynn to be fully human, meaning flawed and toxic at times, loving and supportive at others, that it allows us room to be fully human. And that and we still deserve friendship and love and all of those things. And we need time to work through that. And so I'm hoping that that's where we'll land on that, on the new generation as well.
That's beautiful. And I think we're all kind of pushing against this idea that we have to be perfect super women all the time to be worthy of anything. Everyone's looking for that humanity.
Yes. Yes. And I think that I don't believe in positive images just as much as I don't believe in negative images. I've been trying to paint human images, and we are a spectrum of that. We are not perfect. And unfortunately, I think part of one of a Black woman's drive is, you know, that 10 times better. We got to do it all this just to get what we're like 67 cents on the dollar still.
Right.
You know, just to get 67 cents on the dollar, we felt we needed to be perfect, and we're killing ourselves as a result. We are killing our opportunities to just relax or experience some of the joy that we have fought so hard for. You know what I'm saying? We're not perfect, but we have, but that level of excellence, that so that we can get to a certain place of some survival or some sense of thriving, it's now choking us. You know what I'm saying? We can't be perfect. So be perfect in the moment and be a mess. When you have to be, like, take a bath, whatever, you know what I'm saying? So that you take the personal cues to wellness is what I'm trying to get to. That if we acknowledge that we're not perfect and we need help, I think I want Black women to start asking for that help or taking that time to repair themselves, because we're not perfect.
Yeah, I'm instantly overwhelmed with thoughts of Gabrielle Union in her bathroom with post-it notes. You know what I'm saying? Got the candles going. I'm like, yep. That's my girl, Mary Jane. That's
funny. I'm looking at that image right now. I'm in my loft, and I was, you know, we're just sort of sorting some things out. And I'm literally looking at that image right on the other side of this computer.
There you go. That's the power of your stories. I love it. So in addition to this career journey, the manifestation, I feel like you've been on a personal journey. You go on your Instagram and, like, you were traveling, you know.
Yeah.
You turned 50, and I'm like, where? It's just
right here.
Gray is like sexy though, you know?
You know what? I'm loving my gray. I had a moment with it. And you know, it's funny. The gray has freed me, because like playing with hairstyles to this level, I've never done that. I've been very fortunate with my wash and go hair, and I've just been rocking that all kind of ways. But this has made me, look at my lip. I don't wear bright lip. This is not me. But, well, it wasn't me. It's me now. It's so 50. I feel like I'm a little backwards. I was a breech baby, so maybe I do everything backwards. But I'm now like all the, you know, playing with makeup, playing with hairstyles, to your point, traveling. Approaching 50, but I will have to say it was around Alton Sterling and Philando Castile's death, right after Sandra Bland's death, right around that time. I'm a very optimistic person. But I was like, oh, this is depression. I was like, okay, I don't sit still long enough maybe to get, but I was going there. And my husband wrote this beautiful piece. He put it in, I think it was the Hollywood Reporter, but the anecdote to dying is living. And I looked at my list of dreams and hopes and goals, and I was like, what am I not doing? What am I going to be upset about that I did not try in this lifetime? And I started doing those things. And I think that's one of the spaces I want, and travel is a big part of it. I've always wanted to go to Thailand, and I actually really promote solo travel. Mm-hmm. Especially as a writer, it just opened me up all these things I wanted to do, these callings in us are our spirit, right? And if we don't start answering those calls, it's going to choke us. It's going to kill us. It's going to hurt us. And so I started slowly and then fast paced answering the calls to my spirit. Mm-hmm. And I really feel renewed at 50. I think 50 also puts you in that, like people say, what, the midlife crisis? I would say the midlife celebration. And I'm doing that, and it's involved, like I said, it involves travel, it involves hair changes, it involves lipstick, it involves, oh, red nails. I was never a red nail girl. I mean, it involved.
That's surprising because you're a Delta. You would think that
I am. It's funny, but I just was playing it soft. It's playing it subtle, and it's like,
It looks good though. I love it.
Thank you, these are my grandmother's nails. But the bigger point I'm trying to make is it is time to live. And I think it's in line with what I've been trying to say on my stories to Black women. Accept ourselves, love ourselves, dust ourselves off, and go keep living. Because I think when the world treats Black women the way that we can eventually treat ourselves, which is the queens that we are, but to match our energy about how much we give to the world, if the world treats us that way, I mean, then the axis will spin right again. Earth will be a place, we'll get right again. Black women, we need to step up, and part of stepping up is stepping up for ourselves.
That's beautiful.
Not just everybody else.
I mean, as you say that, I think of Breonna Taylor, a day when a Breonna Taylor can sleep peacefully in her home and not have to worry about being killed. You know, that's the day when we actually will have achieved something. But
yeah,
we're not there yet.
Her Amazon purchases are not perceived as drug runs, right? I mean,
you know, all of that. All of that.
Just a gay shop?
Yeah.
Can't sleep, can't have a boyfriend. Like, what? Just real basic stuff, right?
Basic stuff. Well, you know, I think of the fact that you've said previously that your work is a conversation with the culture. And I know you can't give away all the projects that you're working on at Netflix. And it's beautiful because you're part of this elite club of showrunners. Yeah. You know, I'm thinking Shonda and Kenya, who they really are just, they're like, do your thing, be creative. Here's a blank canvas and do your thing. Can you tell us anything about what we can expect in the coming years? I know that you said you will really focus on anyone whose story is missing from the golden age of TV. So just what types of things can we expect from your work on Netflix?
You know, I have my new company, Story 27 Productions, and it's the extension of what I've always been doing, but it's a reminder that I want to center the marginalized story and have the breadth of their humanity. Mm-hmm. My muse is always going to be Black women and Black people. So I am starting there. But when you ask, what is it that I want to share? I'm only not going to tell you, not from like, I'm trying to be coy, but that's my commerce. That's what I've worked so hard to do, that I feel like I'm hopeful that I've gotten to also a place in my career that hopefully it'll be Christmas for the viewer as well. I don't want to tip my hand. I want to be, you know, people marvel at Meryl Streep. You only see her when she does the work. I just want to do the work. And I want you to be like, oh, that's what she's been doing. I don't know that I always want to tip my hand. I think, you know, hopefully the audience knows, when they come to the story, it is going to be thoughtful in the humanity. It will be rich in the texture. It will be both the spectrum of dramatic and funny. You know, saying it will have our humanity all up and through it. And even if I'm exploring someone else's humanity, that it will be an entryway to remind us that, wow, we all really are more connected than we are different, or connected and divided, or same and different. I also want the space of not having to share so much other than the work, but also want the respect that when I say, hey guys, dinner's ready, y'all come Everybody and eat.
If your name's on it, you know what to make, Mara.
Yeah.
You already know.
But I am enjoying the privilege of, like Lorraine Hansberry has a quote, never be afraid to sit and think a while. I really want to enjoy the privilege of thinking about what the next best thing is and getting deeper and hopefully better in my storytelling.
I love that answer.
Yeah, I also want to bring in new voices. I still want to do what I've always been doing in my career, recognizing the new voices, being a support, being a partner to that, so that we can get more of those stories out that are centering our humanity.
That's great. Well, that leads to my last question, which is for the rookies in the game who are at home and quarantine. You know, they desperately want to pour their hearts out onto paper, and they're worried that their concept won't be accepted, that people won't be ready for it. You were ahead of your time. You know, you've done and told so many stories that, again, people may not have fully understood just how impactful it would be, and then boom, the testament is in the work. So what do you say to that person who's at home writing or creating and wants so badly to be seen or recognized by the industry? Do you have any thoughts? Excuse me.
I would say not to be driven to be seen or recognized by the industry. I would say be driven to tell the story and understand that you are a story of this time. I'm still blessed to be still, I'm still here to be a part of this time, but I'm coming in as a veteran. I call myself like, I'm a veteran, but I'm also a debutante. But the new voices, you are built for this moment. What do you want to say? I think let that be the driver. What do you want to say, and work on that and rewrite till you get it right, till you are impressed, till you get to the point like, did I write that? let that drive you. Let the joy of meeting those characters every day be the thing that drives you. And believe that in the spirit, if God put that in you, that it's already laid out for you. If you do that work, if you're striving to be seen, and this is a dance. I have struggled through that too. Like, I think I've done work that deserved attention. I didn't get that attention. My feelings are hurt. Pull that energy back in and get back to work. And trust that in God's timing, the sun will shine on your face. And look at 20 years later, I'm having all this. I would not have written this for myself, you know? I'm enjoying this moment. And using it as fuel for the next one. And I would say, believe that your moment is coming, but be prepared when it shows up.